Good morning, everyone. So today the topic is I deserve to be happy. Here is Dr. Ali to give the topic, and is will go on for the topic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Venu. Because of the curfew, we are running short of technical support, but Venu has done a wonderful job of getting everything logged in and getting the program going, because I am totally ignorant in these matters with regard to technology. You talk to me about human beings, you talk to me about motivation, inspiration, I can talk to you for the whole day. But you talk to me about FB Live, and I start asking that if FB is live, then are we all dead? Those are the type of silly questions that come in my mind. But I'm thankful that people like Venu are here, who take care of all these things, so that I can just sit here and enjoy my interactions with you. Okay, so let us get going. One of my team members very nicely suggested the topic. That is that I deserve to be happy, and that leads to the motivation that yes, I will do something to see that I am happy. Happiness, as I have always been saying, and I think most of you are aware of it, it comes from within, and the same thing happens to motivation. Somewhere along the line, people are not fully aware, or at the practical level, they are not very conscious of the fact that nobody else can motivate you. Please understand the difference. Somebody can encourage you, somebody can praise you, somebody can do hand-holding with you, somebody can pull you and push you. All that can be done. But motivation, that which is that, you know, desire that I want to do something, I want to take charge of my life, I want to be responsible for whatever I am doing or whatever is happening to me in life, and I will be, what they say, no, proactive. That means I will not keep passing the buck, I will not, you know, wait for somebody to inspire me, encourage me. I will do what I want to. Of course, if you are surrounded with people who do encourage you and who do push you and who do appreciate you, it goes a long way in increasing your motivation. But always remember that that cannot be the prime mover of motivation. The prime mover of motivation comes from within. The same way I keep seeing, since we are talking about the fact that I deserve to be happy, I keep seeing people forcibly looking as though they are motivated. Take students, for example. You know, a lot of students who you will see sit for hours together studying. It may appear to you that this student is very motivated. See, from the time he gets up till the time he goes to sleep, he is with his books, he is going on studying. But I want to clarify, this student has been forcibly motivated. This student has been told that if you do not study 16 hours a day, and if you don't compete, and if you don't come up to certain standards, you will fail in the exam, and it will be a humiliation, and you will not get admission, you will not have a good future. So what is that student doing? The student is not studying because he is motivated. He is studying because he is scared. He is studying that I will be left behind, I will be humiliated, I will be letting down my parents. Therefore, that student is performing and studying. Exactly the same thing happens at work level. And more so in the last maybe 20 years or so, I have seen a drastic change of motivation levels among people in the corporate world. Thankfully, in the non-corporate world, I see a lot of people who are highly motivated. One very commendable section of profession that I always appreciate is teachers. I see teachers who are keeping up their work, being part of the education process, teaching children for a salary which is probably 20-30% of what they can earn outside in the corporate world. Money is one thing. The other is, at times they are teaching in a school where the leader or the seniors or colleagues are not very nice to her. They still say, I'm going for the sake of my little children. I'm not going for the sake of my bosses or my colleagues or sometimes even nasty parents. It's okay, I can handle them. Because primarily what is my motivation to be a teacher? It is the welfare of the children. It is the growth of the children. It is the joy that I get by interacting with the children. Doesn't matter whatever salary I'm getting, whatever the terms, conditions are. Similarly, there are so many other sectors, social workers, many, many, many doctors and medical professionals I see who don't care how much money they are earning or what they are getting financially. They say that I am there to ensure the good health of the patients who come to me, and they work for them. Defense and military people, they sometimes work in very, very difficult circumstances. But yet you ask them and they will say, no, I would not do anything else except this. Because this is my passion. This is what I, love to do. Now, all these I'm giving you as examples to show you how motivators cannot be external. It has been proven time and again. Let's say there's an organization where people are not being paid very high salaries, and over a period of time the bosses feel that they are losing their motivation and they are not performing to the extent that they should. So they say, okay, now that we have some money, etc., we will jack up all the salaries by 50%. Wow. One shot and salaries have been jacked up by 50%. How thrilled those employees are. Prior to that, they used to get 5%, 10% increment per year. Now in one shot, they've got 50% increase in their salary. Research and surveys have shown that it's just a matter of a few days, few weeks, maximum few months that the people get used to the new salary. They raise up their economic standards. They raise up their style of living. So where they were surviving on 10 rupees, now their expenses become 15 rupees because they are earning 50% more. And within no time, they realize that there's nothing great happening. Life is still going on the same way. And that motivation is lost. They're not performing 50% better or even at times 5% better. This is just to give you an example that let us not think that you can motivate somebody by money, you can motivate somebody by whatever the means. We need to understand that motivation comes from within. Now, before I talk to you about how, what, where motivation is and how it can be developed, let us first also reflect on the fact that there are some people who inevitably seem to be, not motivated. Why does that, happen? Why is it that, there are people who just do not feel motivated enough to do, perform or work better or to develop some better skills or to progress in life? Very often, it is connected to their self-esteem. If they feel that I am not a worthy person, I am not a capable person, then the person's motivation automatically goes down. Again, from students to adults. A student who feels, whatever I do, I will never be able to perform to the extent that is being expected from me. I will never be able to come up to the standard of my teachers or my parents. Once a student starts feeling that way, the student will never ever put in the type of efforts that is required by student from time to time. Same thing happens at the adult level. I am working, I am trained, I am capable, but I don't really feel like working. I push myself to go to work, put in whatever is the minimum that is required, and from there I just feel okay, so be it. What's the point in earning more? There are so many people who seem to think that this motivation, this struggling and this and that is meant for the initial years. Even a simple thing like if I ask somebody, what is your ambition in life? Some people laugh and say, hey, I'm 36 years old, I'm 54 years old. What do you mean ambition in life? I'm not a kid to have ambitions. Now that's what I want to ask. Why is it that only kids need to have an ambition? Everybody asks children, what is your ambition? What do you want to do? You must do great things in life. You must achieve this. You must achieve that. All that goes on. But nobody asks adults. Nobody asks, for example, a retired person. You're 60 years old and you have superannuated. You are healthy, fit, fine. You're probably going to live a minimum of 30 years more, out of which at least 20, 30 years you can lead a productive life the way healthcare is going. So what is your ambition now? What do you want to do future in life? People, believe me, are sometimes even surprised that such a question is being asked. At this age and this stage of my life, what are you asking? Here I'm a retired person, what are you talking about? But why can't a retired person have an ambition or a goal or the desire to be happier and to achieve something more in life in some way? Need not necessarily be financial or from job or money point of view. Person can do so many other things, no? That is what I am helping you to understand about how people so often do not even understand the basic meaning of motivation. Anupama has rightly said, people who live in the past are very difficult to motivate. That's what I meant when I said self-esteem. That's exactly what I meant by saying that I am not worth it. I cannot get good marks, or I will not be appreciated. I will never get a promotion, however hard I work. So why should I work? Hema Malini rightly says that there are times when your motivation is high and at time motivation is low. There's no consistency in motivation. How can you keep motivation constantly there at all times? No, you cannot. It is like any other mood or any other emotion. You can't constantly be happy, right? There are times when you're happy. There are times when you're a little happy. There are times when you're sad. There are times when you're neutral. There are times when you're nostalgic. And suddenly something happens and you're very happy. So see how every emotion like this keeps going up and down. Same thing happens with motivation. Let us not look at motivation as something ideal that, we should have it all the time, and every time we should be motivated, we should be running all the time. In fact, that is something that I have been cautioning people against. There are a lot of people who think that motivation is directly to do with material success. How much am I earning? What is my designation? What is the type of promotions that I have got? How many steps I have climbed up the ladder? People who get motivated by such artificial means, they are somewhere the bubble is going to burst. I gave you the example of an organization where they jack up the salaries by 50% and say now everybody should be so happy that they should be motivated and they should at least give us 50% more productivity over a period of time. It just doesn't happen that way. So I do not want you to aim that your motivation should always be high. Whether you like it or not, your motivation will go down at times. There are so many factors involved in it. Let's say I'm working very hard and I get a boss who is not appreciative. It's perfectly understandable that my motivation goes down. When my motivation goes down and I realize that I am not performing the way I used to when I had a good boss, that is what helps you to introspect. Shiv Shankari is asking, is it bad to choose to live a simple life? No, definitely not. In fact, that's what I was coming to when I spoke about people, you know, who are perpetually apparently motivated and who want to always keep doing something and they always want to be achievers and they want to be working 24/7 and they literally become what we define as workaholics. They feel that the world is on their shoulders, the world, the organization, the department will not survive without them, and they have to go on and on and on rising up the ladder. Somebody rightly said there are so many people who keep climbing up the ladder, reach the roof and realize that they have climbed up the wrong roof. They should have gone to some other building and they've come on this building just because they were so busy climbing. In fact, there again is that very, very popular children's story, you know, about the woodcutter and his cutting of the trees. When this woodcutter was told that for every tree that you cut, you will get so much money, he was enthused. He was highly motivated. And every morning he would get up, have a nice healthy breakfast, pack his tiffin, go running and start chopping the trees. But over a period of time, his productivity started coming down. Where he was cutting, let's say, 10 trees in a day, it became 9, it became 8, it became 7. And he started putting in more and more effort, working harder and harder. But his productivity was continuously coming down. The answer to that, I'm sure most of you know it, is very obvious. That he was forgetting to sharpen the axe. The axe with which he was cutting the trees was getting blunt. But in his enthusiasm that no, I should not waste time doing anything else. I must have a healthy breakfast, pack a good tiffin for lunch and go straight to the jungle and start chopping the trees. So if you forget to sharpen your mental axe, stop and think. One of the best quotes which I have heard and I keep repeating every now and then is, if you get into the rat race, if you decide I'm going to work, I'm going to earn, I'm going to achieve, I'm going to go up that corporate career radar and those type of things, even if you win the rat race, you are still a rat. That's what I said, that you put a ladder on a building and you're climbing faster and faster and faster without realizing that when you go on the terrace, it will be the wrong terrace. And then what do you do? So sometimes it is absolutely necessary to stop and think, where am I headed? Noor Saba has said something very nice. You can choose to live a simple life provided you have high thinking. Let us define what is this high thinking. High thinking should be something which gives you a sense of satisfaction, not necessarily happiness. That's what I told you. You cannot be motivated all the time the same way as you cannot be happy all the time. So it should be a state of high thinking where you have satisfaction, you have a clear conscience, you have a sense of fulfillment, and equally important, you are taking others with you. Others should turn around and say, hey, this is a good guy, he is a wonderful person, whatever he may be, whatever his riches, his status, his whatever else is there. But I know that this guy is a nice person. I feel blessed to have him as my acquaintance, my friend, my colleague, whatever. When that happens, then you know that you, what you are doing is based on high thinking. You don't have to be spiritual and a very accomplished and a self-actualized person, but if you can follow these two simple norms, questioning where am I headed and what is the deeper meaning to whatever I'm doing, and whatever I'm doing, am I taking others along with me? Otherwise, you will not be able to succeed. There's another story which circulated a lot long back. You know, there was an order for live crabs to be exported. So, a lot of people started catching live crabs, putting them into crates and bringing them to the docks, from where they would be put on the ship and they would be sent to whichever place the order was placed from. One gentleman was visiting that port, and he peeped and saw there was this huge crate with hundreds of live crabs in it, but it did not have a cover. He immediately called the supervisor and said, "Hey, there are hundreds of crabs in this open crate. They will climb and walk out of it. You haven't put a cover." The supervisor came, had one look at the crabs and says, "Don't worry, sir. We won't waste money on a cover." "What do you mean? They are live crabs, yeah? They can climb over the wall of the crate and jump out." He said, "No, they won't." He said, "How can you be so confident?" He said, "Have a look, stand there and see." And this man was watching. Out of all the crabs that were roaming around on the crate's bottom, one started climbing up. Just when he was nearing the top and he would have found freedom, two other crabs caught hold of his legs and pulled him down. Whenever another crab tried to grow up, these crabs pulled him down. So the supervisor explained that these are such jealous crabs. They don't want to see anybody among their group, you know, succeeding or going on to better things. And that is why you can be sure that none of these crabs will go up. That is what, you know, happens so many times. Can we say spiritual gurus are always motivated? No idea. I am a person who has not made any headway in spirituality. You should ask, you know, the knowledgeable people. There are so many genuine gurus. I do come across people who lead a very clean and a very nice life. They will enlighten you on it. But I am a person who sticks to the basics of human beings, human welfare, and this. How to motivate youngsters under drug influence. Now, these two things are not connected to each other. Motivating a person and helping a person get out of the habit of being in the influence of drugs are two totally different things. We should not mix them up. Yes, I do agree that if a person, if a youngster, instead of working towards his goal, studying better, socializing, doing whatever he likes to, is getting into the habit of drugs, let us say, there is something wrong. I mentioned to you earlier about a basic thing like self-esteem. Quite possible that that youngster has low self-esteem. I keep on reminding about the epidemic of loneliness. Quite possible that despite having friends, despite having a good family, he may still be feeling lonely, isolated. These are the factors which lead to a person looking for escape. I'm not happy doing my routine stuff. I'm a student. I'm supposed to study, give exams, spend time in some extracurricular activities, do some sports or something. But I'm not happy doing that. What do I do? So he starts looking for shortcuts. And when he gets into drugs, he realizes that the mind is so calm, soothing. I am away from all the worries of the world temporarily for that few hours. So every time he comes back to normalcy, again he goes back into the drugs. Okay, but that, as I said, is not necessarily connected to motivation. Poonam has asked, "Please answer my query," but I have not seen your query. Poonam, if you can I've seen it now. How housewives motivate themselves as they have nothing to show their progress in life, because it is a truth that who earns or professionally active is only worthy in minds of society. So, to start with answering Poonam's question, I would like to ask you, what is your definition of society? Society constitutes around you dozens, hundreds of people. You have your neighbors, you have your relatives, you have people whom you meet socially, you have your old classmates. All these constitute society, right? Majority of the people in society are insensitive to you. They're least bothered what you do. They are in their world of their own. And unfortunately, they also look for scandals. So if something negative happens to you, not even negative, let's say you're not earning, you have decided to be a full-time homemaker to take care of your family. It's such a noble thing, it's such a great sacrifice. And it's a 24/7 job as compared to the people who go to an office and work for 8 hours or 10 hours in a day. Yet, these people consider that as something not worthy and they put that person down. Agreed. But you can always find some people who understand the significance of a homemaker. One. Secondly, if you are a full-time homemaker, do you advertise? Do you sell yourself? See, a person who works, particularly a person who works in a established or a reputed position, he will always sell himself. Even as you are introducing, that person will say, I am a neurosurgeon, I have qualified from UK and now I am working in such and such multi-speciality hospital and I head the department of neurosurgery. Oh, everybody looks up at him. Whatever it may be. I am a businessman, I have got 4 branches all over the state. I have this. Ah, this guy is great. I am working in such and such office and now I am the senior deputy director and I am in charge of this. Ah, this person looks very impressive. When somebody asks this lady, what about you? You know what is the typical answer, no? I am just a housewife. The person did not say, I am just a neurosurgeon. The person did not say, I am just a senior deputy director. The person did not say, I am just a businessman. Why does the housewife say, I am just a housewife? And you know what they add to that? I don't work. Whenever somebody says such a thing to me, I turn around and say, oh, how lucky you are. From morning to night, you just relax, sleep, have 3 naps in a day, watch TV, is it? No, sir, where? I've got 2 small children, I've got so many commitments, I've got my elder parent also living with me, I have to look after everybody in the house. It's very hectic. Okay. Then why did you say that I do not work? No, what I said was that I don't go to an office and work, I don't have a salary or a designation. I said all the more. A person who's working for a salary is working for a salary when you're working for not a salary. And yet you are working, yet you are motivated, yet you want to give the best to your family. Don't you think that you are at a higher level? I had a very wonderful student who is now settled down abroad. She's very well built, very smart, tall, very impressive personality she has. You know, when we start our 1-year program, the Diploma in Counseling Skills DCS, one of the things that we do right in the beginning is to ensure that everybody gets to know each other very well. So we give them an opportunity. Why don't you introduce yourself and give a few details about yourself? So like I said, no, somebody was saying I'm working in this or I'm retired from there or I have a business or I'm a teacher. So many said I'm just a housewife. This lady gets up and says, I am the Commissioner of Home Affairs and ex officio Director of Child Welfare. Everybody's eyes popped out. Oh my, she seems to be somebody right up there, some IAS, IPS, something. She must be holding this type of post. And then she said, in other words, I am a mother and a homemaker. Commissioner of Home Affairs, my home. Director of Child Development, my children. Now, when you project yourself in the correct way, then this so-called society wakes up and starts appreciating you. You have to sell yourself. Right? A person who was in depression needs motivation to get involved in life. Yes. Person who was in depression, person who went through major setbacks, person who put in efforts and yet failed despite all his very strong efforts. Obviously, it's very understandable that such a person gets, loses his motivation. What you can do, I'll be coming to that in a few minutes, so just be a little patient. See, I was talking about people who work without getting a salary, like the homemaker. The same thing we have seen in our 300 volunteers of Helping Hand. They don't get a single rupee. They don't even get bus fare to come to the hospital or the center where they are giving their voluntary services. They want a cup of tea. They go to the canteen of the hospital, pay money and have their tea or coffee and come back. They have no designation. Nobody gets up and salams them. Yet their motivation level is very high. You can ask any Helping Hand volunteer who's been working for years and years. They're growing older. They become 70, 80. Some of them are nearing 90. They still continue to be motivated and they continue to work. And that comes from, as I told you, from within. It does not matter what others think of you. A group of our volunteers had a very bad experience in one government hospital. A big shot politician turned up over there. And I don't know what he was angry about. He started taking out his anger on everybody. And he came to our Helping Hand desk in the hospital and shouted at the volunteers and called the superintendent and said, who are these outsiders and what are they doing here and why are they interfering in the matters of our hospital. How do you allow such people to come in? Please stop all this. Poor superintendent had no choice. This fellow was a big shot politician. Immediately he told our volunteers, please don't come from tomorrow. Now normally that could have been a very bad demotivator, right? People could have felt, I have been giving free services day in and day out, week after week, for months, years, to this hospital where poor people come because it's a government hospital. And I have been summarily thrown out, almost humiliated and thrown out. How bad they should have felt. You will be amazed to know that at least 80% of those volunteers just sought out which is the other hospital that I can go to, since we're working in 9 hospitals, which is the most convenient next hospital that I can go to. So instead of this hospital, from next week, I'm going to that other hospital. And I continue to do my selfless and my voluntary services. This is how the motivation works from within. So to answer your question, including a person who's gone through depression, a person who's gone through failures and all that, there are ways and means which I'll come to in a few minutes. Navina says, I think homemakers should find their passion, sit with themselves, and first feel that they are worthy enough to feel proud of themselves. Absolutely right. And that is why the blurb in today's session or topic, that I deserve to be happy. If I boost myself up, if I understand my self-worth, and if I say I deserve to be happy, that lays the foundation for the motivation. And always remember, motivation has nothing to do with the role that you play. Just because you have been promoted to senior deputy director, or you are the head of department of neurology, or you are now the principal of the school, that is not enough to motivate you. Just because you got a 50% increment in your salary, that is not enough to motivate you. It should come from, within. And one more before I answer your other questions and specifically talk about how to build motivation. Please remember, motivation changes from time to time. That's why I said that don't expect that you will be fully motivated at all times. sometimes there will be a setback. For example, now you have seen now with COVID and even earlier, when a major death takes place, somebody who is very close to you, somebody who really admired, loved, respected, that person passes away. It's very understandable for the person who is being bereaved to think, what is the purpose in life? What am I struggling for? What am I aiming at? Why am I chasing happiness? Because finally, the end result is going to be death. I am also going to be cremated and burnt like this person did. For all the things that he or she did in life, finally this is the end. Nothing wrong with it. It's very understandable. Live with it, accept that feeling. Understand that at this stage my motivation is low and will be low for some time. Over a period of time, when the grieving process starts kicking in and you start reflecting over the lives, then you start working towards doing something. Okay, before I answer the rest of your questions, I will answer, whether it's a person who's gone through depression or anything of that sort. You want to strengthen, improve, and enhance your motivation. One of the first things that you can, you should do is to review your small and big setbacks that have happened in life. I went through depression. I failed in the exam. I was thrown out of my job. I suffered a bad relationship where I was ill-treated by somebody whom I cared for. List them down. Review them. If any one of them are still existing, make sure that at least in your own mind, mentally, emotionally, resolve it to say, yes, whatever has happened, it is very bad, it has hurt me very badly, but I will not allow it to permanently pull me down. So I need to work on these issues, iron them out, and make sure that they do not affect me now. The second step would be to review your goals and your priorities now. Even if your goal is to live one day at a time, am I willing to face the consequences? I'm not setting long-term goals. So I may not get that big wealth or big this or whatever normally people set their goals on. I'm not going to get it. I'm not going to regret. I'm going to say I lived one day at a time. I lived a fulfilling life. And today when I don't have something great to achieve, but other people with lofty goals and those sort of things have achieved, it doesn't matter. I am satisfied with myself. So every now and then, review what are your goals. And goals keep changing. No? There's a time when I am young, I want to make money. There's a time when I have a family and I say I want to have a house to take care of my family. There are times when I am getting old and I want to become more spiritual or whatever. So there are so many ways in which keep reviewing your priorities and your goals. The third point is, please list down people who look down upon you and demotivate you. As somebody had pointed out, that society looks down upon you, oh, you are just a housewife, that sort of thing. So in that society, who are these people? It will not be the entire society, I can assure you. So identify. I have that neighbor lady who lives down the road and who works in an office, so she thinks she is superior to me and she makes these comments. I have this so-and-so among my in-laws, my sister-in-law or somebody like that, who says that my brother is the one who's slogging away in office the whole day, you just sit at home and relax, and she has this tendency to put me down. Make a list of such people, and if you can get away from them, insulate yourself from them, nothing like it. If you can't do that, try to mentally insulate yourself from them and move on to the fourth step, which is look for people who can be a positive influence. There are people like that around you. It's not very difficult to find. Quite often we ignore them. We don't really give sufficient importance to them. Make a conscious effort by identifying them, going closer to them, giving them what they want, reciprocating to them, strengthening your bond with them. And based on that, when you see people who have a positive mental attitude surrounding you, the chances of your building up motivation are higher. The fifth point is, tone down your expectations. As we grow older, as we have different experiences in life, we should learn that we cannot achieve everything. There are youngsters who come and say, I want to go only to IIT, I won't go to any other engineering college. It's good, okay, they are enthusiastic, they are motivated, they are whatever it is, I don't deny it to them. But 10 years later, when you're working somewhere and you've done your engineering from whichever institution, are you able to look and say that, yes, sometimes you get something, sometimes you don't get something, but that's not the end of the world, right? So I will tone down my expectations, set more realistic example. And simultaneously comes point number six, that is, list down your strengths. That's a very important aspect of strengthening your motivation. What are my strengths? Am I utilizing my strengths or not? And strengths can also include contacts. I have this one or two friends who will always stand by me. So they are my assets, they are my strengths. I have a bank balance, so if I don't earn for X days also, I can still survive. That's my strength. I keep very good health. I can, you know, do strenuous work. Even though I'm growing older, it doesn't matter. I still have very good health and I can physically do things, which doesn't matter if they don't, pull me down. All your strengths. Once you have done all this, the seventh point is, keep giving yourself positive affirmations. Give yourself compliments, positive strokes, appreciation. Put it down in writing now and then. Hey, you are such an honest person. You had an opportunity to cheat somebody and take advantage. You didn't do that. You stuck to your principles and your values. These are the type of things, you know, which help you to understand how the motivation factor works. And last, eighth point is, record your progress. See, record your progress. Very small progress also, very minor progress also. At this point, before I move into the last phase of answering the questions which are already there in the chat box, etc., I just want to introduce to you briefly one of my very wonderful colleagues who, at some point, despite being very successful in his career, money-wise, status-wise, working environment-wise, typical corporate, IT, things, felt, no, this is not what I'm looking for. I want to do something different. At 45, 50 years of age, it's not that easy. As I told you, many people say, what ambition, what goal? I'm already 47 years old. I'm already this, that. But he didn't do that. He found a new path. Within 5 years, he has blossomed out as a counselor. He's one of the key pillars of Banjaram. Some of you may have met him. But for those who you have not met, I want to introduce you to Sridhar Srinivasan.
Hi, morning. Just wanted to say hello. Worked in the IT industry, like as Ali was saying. So somewhere I thought, like, beyond a limit, my lifestyle was not going to change. So I wanted to do something else with my life. And so I decided to come into counseling. I prepared myself. I completed my DCS, quit my job, and I've been with Banjara for the last close to 7 years now, like as a counselor. Before that, I was a student for 2 years on life skills and DCS. It's been an amazing journey. And I'm finding that peace and happiness I was always looking for, and like somewhere I feel that fulfillment. So it's been a very enriching experience so far.
Thank you, Sridhar. They're small things. I mean, again, if you ask in terms of material, this thing that, okay, by becoming a counselor, did you make so many millions? Or did you get that recognition? Have you won some award? Nothing of that sort. That's why I say that motivation has to come from within, not from external sources. That you have to make it very happy. Tulsi has asked how to make happy children and motivate. The best thing to motivate children is to be motivated yourself. You should be a role model. I know, for example, we were talking about homemakers and full-time housewives. I know of mothers who say things like, my life is over, I have done whatever I can, what is there in life for me? But I want my child to be happy, I want my child to be motivated, I want my child to succeed. It doesn't work that way. Motivation is contagious. Why did I tell you that surround yourself with people who have a positive attitude in life? Now, if you are a parent and you do not have a positive attitude, you can break your head with a child and try to push and pull and motivate it, you will not succeed. Show the child certain, see, that's another thing. Children or adults, whatever you are, should have certain goals. It can be a very small, very minor goal, it can be a very lofty goal, that's your choice. But if you have something to look forward to, that builds up the hope. And once the hope comes in, you start working towards something. Let me share with you the story about the first handicapped woman, a girl who had polio legs, who had no strength in her legs, she couldn't walk. The first such person who swam across the English Channel. English Channel, as it is even for able-bodied people, is a very difficult task to swim from one end to the other. She was the first handicapped person who said, I'm going to swim the English Channel. Okay? So she jumped in France into the English Channel, started swimming towards England. And there was a boat following her to record her progress. She swam and swam and swam and swam. At some point, her strength gave up. And she said, no, I can't. I'm going to sink. And she waved out to the boat. They came and pulled her into the boat. And when she got into the boat, they said, England is much closer than France, so we will take you to England and from there you can fly back. And within a few minutes, the boat reached England. And she was shocked. She realized that the British coast inevitably has a fog around it most of the days. So she could not see the coastline of England, she could not see her goal. And even though she had covered 70-80% of her journey, she gave up. So the next time she said, I will cross on a day when there is no fog. She waited and waited and waited. One fine day when the weather was absolutely clear, no sign of a fog, she repeated her attempt. She jumped in from France, swam and swam and swam and swam, and she started getting tired, exhausted. When she felt that, no, I can't go further, she put her head up and looked carefully. And she saw the coastline of England. And she said, there, my goal. And she would put her head down and swim and swim and swim and swim. Totally exhausted, she would pull her head out and look. Hey, now I can see the mountains and I can see the geographical shapes. I've come much closer to the coastline of England. And again she swam, till she could see the trees and everything. Again she swam and she made it. This is what I mean. Children do not have goals. And many of us adults also don't have goals. Navina says, I think homemakers should find their passion, sit with themselves and first feel that they are worthy enough to feel proud of themselves. 100% I agree with you. Please follow Navina's advice and do it. All of you who are homemakers and who are not, you know, defined as professionals. As a teacher, how can I motivate students who have low self-esteem? You have to first work on low self-esteem. That's a topic by itself. Time and again, I work on that. I also brought out a book, a small workbook on how to build self-esteem. You can order it from Banjara office and take it and use it with your students. As a teacher, if you are taking the interest and getting involved in building the self-esteem of your students, nothing like it. You are really giving them a great service, and that will lay the foundation for the students to improve and increase their motivation. The person has to realize for seeking help. How do we get him to take it? Gently keep making the person aware. Don't push. Don't force. Don't point fingers and say, hey, you need to improve here. You're slipping back there. You are failing here. Person starts withdrawing further. Just gently bring this thing. Be it self-esteem, be it motivation, anything of that sort. Hey, you know, last Saturday I was listening to this person called Ali and he was talking about this self-esteem thing. And I was wondering how this happens, and then he said that there is a workbook. So I was just thinking about it. That way, you are gently nudging the person to take it forward. What's the difference between inspiration and motivation? Inspiration is a sort of flash that comes to you. I get inspired to do. I have a role model. I read about something, or I, you know, come across some scriptures or something like that, and suddenly there is an I feel that inspiration coming within me. Now that has to be converted into motivation. Motivation is a long-term thing. Motivation is something which you have to build up, you know, and it takes you through steps. Inspiration can come and disappear also for some time, but whenever you feel inspired by watching somebody, seeing somebody who's a role model, or seeing somebody who has done something very meaningful in life, and you feel inspired, hey, I can also do something on those lines, at least partially I can do something, and you can start working towards that. Housewives are the best motivators. Let's not get into best and second best competition, otherwise everybody will say no, we are best motivators. Yes, Anjana, it is, you do need to sell yourself. That's the type of society that we live in. It is unfortunate, but it is a fact. Yes, Ainaz has spoken about our own Mr. Ramaswamy. I call him Father Teresa. Amazing work he does. It is unbelievable. The motivation that he has within. He just does not bother whether there is a lockdown, whether there is a pandemic, whether people are getting infected with COVID. He just goes on and on and on with whatever he does on a daily basis. Today I got a call from such and such cancer patient who has come from West Bengal, doesn't speak the local language, doesn't have any contacts. I am going to go there to that Kidwai hospital, call him there and meet him at some such place. I'm going to, you know, speak the language. He always says that I have speak Shivaji Nagar Hindi, and lot of North Indians who come from different places, they sometimes laugh at my Hindi, but I get along with them. Even understanding that language need not be a limitation between people. If we talk good and praise about yourself, they call it self-boosting. Let them call it. Let them say whatever they want to. When you know that you are not boasting, you are, and you don't have to praise yourself in front of these people. You just have to state facts. You know, I have joined Helping Hand of Banjara, and I go once in a week to such and such place, and I spend 3 hours there doing this work. It gives me a lot of satisfaction. You don't have to say, I am reaching out to people, I am doing great work, I am this and. No, let him. Now, despite that, there will be some people who say, oh, this man was talking that he does some great volunteering work. What's so great about that? He was boasting. Let them say they are jealous people. Please understand that they are the jealous and envious people. They cannot cause any harm to you if you do not give them any significance or importance. Can pets be motivated? Noor is asking. Yes. In fact, pets motivate us more than anything else. You just see a dog wagging his tail at you, and it need not be your pet dog also. It could be a dog on the street who wags his tail at you. What a great, you know, boost I get when I see that. Forget about me motivating the pet or the dog. Homemakers need to draw boundaries for making others realize their worth. To some extent we should do that, but I repeat again that my motivation, my self-esteem should not be limited to or governed by what others say about me. Whether they realize my worth or not should not be very important. Okay, 1, 2, 3 people who are important in your life to you. Put in all the efforts to convince them and to tell them the value of what you are doing. But not to everybody. There will always be jealous, envious people, or people who have nothing to do, who involve themselves in idle gossip. Just don't bother about that. Motivation is a zeal to look forward to something and do any work with passion and enthusiasm. It definitely comes from. That's what I've been saying all this while. Okay. Poonam says, sometimes we need particular person praising to feel motivated. That I want to caution you against, Poonam. If you say, only when X appreciates I feel motivated, there's something wrong. Please understand that X is an individual in his own right. He has his own value systems, he has his own attitudes, he has his own preferences. For whatever the reason, he does not appreciate or praise you. He doesn't think that what you are doing is great. You must rise above that. Do not put all your eggs in one basket and say that only when I get praise from such and such person, then I feel motivated. Surekha says, how to tune in with the field of intention of staying with cheer even when someone significant radiates indifference to you. Time and again I have been dealing with this topic. There will always be somebody around you who puts you down or radiates that indifference or something. You have to mentally insulate yourself. It can be done. There are techniques like thought stopping, which I keep sending whenever somebody says that, you know, this negative thought about this person and what that person said always keeps ringing in my ear. Whenever I try to do something good, these thoughts keep coming and bugging me. So I tell them that there are these techniques, you know, and it could be your own husband, somebody says. It could be just about anybody. It's not important who that person is. Once we decide to be happy, we realize many of our worries were baseless. Deciding is more important, says Lila, and I agree with you. Even to some extent, if they were not really baseless, they had some small base in it, so be it. How does it make a difference to me? As long as my conscience is clear, as long as I'm moving in the right direction, as long as I'm introspecting from time to time, what are my motivators? What makes me happy? What makes me feel fulfilled? And to what extent I'm doing it? I cannot do it 100% also. Keep that in mind. Don't aim for perfection. You will always be an unhappy and a demotivated person. Seema is saying, hi, Sri. Oh, Anupama is saying, hi, Sri. Bharti is saying, hi, Sri. Vinita is saying, hello, Sridhar, sir. Hey, nobody said so many highs to me. The moment Sri came in, we are getting so many highs, but I'm glad because I'm happy that he was here. So that at least if some of you who have not met him, I wanted to introduce. He's such a strong and a solid pillar. You know, many a time whenever I need counseling support at a more mature and a more understanding level to help people who are taking certain decisions, who are at crossroads in their life, he does wonderful work and he does hand-holding to whatever extent is required till he feels that yes, this person can now walk on his own, and you know, I will now encourage him to find his own path. So these are the type of people who are inspirations to me, who give me that feeling that yes, I am capable because I'm surrounded by such people. Each one of them, the way they are doing things, somebody who has given up a top-notch corporate career and come, somebody who is, you know, giving up the comforts of a luxurious house and family to come and give voluntary services, somebody who has reached you know, high positions and retired and says that now I want to do something more meaningful. These are all the people who give that little push and who give that inspiration or encouragement. All these things go to influencing my mind, and they can influence your mind also. And when you sort of, you know, put all of them together, it is like you are trying to make a lovely dish. So you have the all the ingredients coming in, lovely fresh produce from the farms. You have the salt, you have the pepper, you have the oil, you have this, you have that. As long as you put them in all in the correct way, at the end of it, while it is cooking, it looks so horrible, but once it is done, it's a delicious dish that comes out. That is what motivation does to you. If you have that right type of motivation, automatically the world starts looking as a better place. It's amazing how it happens. I can't describe to you what you feel and how you are going to feel through this. I can only tell you, please make the efforts. Isha says, Banjara taught me how to move on peacefully. Always look forward to hear Ali's talk. I'm not Dr. Ali Irshad, I'm only Ali you. I want you to remember that also. And Deepa says, what if you don't achieve your goals? Again, reset. I told you, don't set high parameters. Bring down your goals and start working on it. Right? So with that, as you know, we always stick to our timings. We start at 11, we close at 12. Next week, we are going to be talking about some children who have some additional needs, some special needs, who need a little more than the usual education and routine. How do we identify such children? How do we deal with such children? I would request you to please log in next Saturday. You don't know when, where you'll come across such a child, you will be able to help them. So keep up with your good work. Thanks a lot for being such loyal listeners when I talk every Saturday. It gives me a lot of joy, I can assure you, just to see that you are all there with me. And I wish you a wonderful weekend, and hopefully from Monday onwards a little more unlock to help us to move out and do better things. Thank you and bye-bye. How do I log out?